In the Steven Spielberg movie Jaws, why did the shark like to eat people?
No reason.
In The Room, why did we unfortunately have to see Tommy Wiseau's rear end?
No reason.
And worst of all, why is Rob Schneider in every single Adam Sandler film? No reason. Why am I sat on the toilet giving you this speech?
No reason.
You'll find in most movies there are that element of, why is this even happening?
There's no reason for it.
It's like Marmite. You either love it or you hate it. I'm gone, I'm one wipe away. Ladies and gentlemen, the review you're about to watch is a brilliant exercise in the term no reason. Now if you excuse me.
I'd give that 10 minutes if I were you. When cycling through the city at night,
it's the month of January, and that means it's theme month. And this month's theme is...
Fan Appreciation!
That's right. So this month is dedicated to you, the viewer. So how are we going to do this for you, the viewer? Well, you have been sending us many requests for films over the past year or so. So after a long bit of deliberation, we decided to consult that list and take two films that you have recommended. So to start it all off, the very first one that you have recommended is going to be introduced to you by
me.
Yes.
This week we've chosen the film that was requested by none other than Mr. Daniel Dawson, pictured here looking like Wayne from Wayne's World on his stag do when we went to Liverpool. This film is the 2010 film Rubber.
Ooh, it sounds naughty.
Yes. Written by Quentin, and I've struggled with his name, so I'm just going to call him Quentin. Basically, he is Mr. Wazzo. Yeah. That fella, the man who invented that little hairy yellow man from the Levi's advert. I remember him. What a great guy. But yeah, this film is Rubber. It's basically about Robert, the tyre, who discovers that he's got deadly telekinetic powers. And on discovery of his deadly telekinetic powers, he decides to go on a rampage and target a small desert town. Because, let's be honest, if there's a killer tyre on the loose, no one's going to suspect him, are they?
Because nobody ever suspects the butterfly.
And when he finds his deserted desert town that he's going to wreak havoc on, he finds a mysterious girl who becomes the object of his obsession. When this film was first shown at the Sundance Festival, it divided the audience totally. Some thought that it was genius because it was so stupid, and others hated it because...
it was so stupid.
Exactly. Apparently Fangoria said that they'd never seen, in all the years they've been going to film festivals, you know, Sundance, Cannes, the International Film Festival of Fly That Doesn't Exist Festival, they'd never seen such a diverse and divided audience. And I have to talk with my hands, I kind of feel like lurky buddy, because I don't know what to do with my hands right now. It's an odd film. It really, really is. But it's basically ticks all quotas. It should be a fantastic film. But the fact that shit just gets blown up left, right, everything that you can think of gets blown up. I mean, in my opinion, Robert the Tyre would have been the ultimate counterpart and counteract the Killer Rabbit from Monty Python and the Holy Grail. Look.
I warned you.
I've done it again.
I warned you, but did you listen to me? Oh, no, you knew it all, didn't you? Oh, it's just a harmless little bunny, isn't it? Well, it's always the same. I always tell them to their...
See, that's how you should have dealt with him. He was a nasty, nasty rabbity type rabbit. And that's what they should have done with him. They should have blown him up. It's an interestingly made for the fact that you're watching this film happening, but then there's like an audience as well. There's, you know, kind of from all walks of life. You've got the cool hip girls who, as if anyone watches this program religiously, knows that they're the type of people that I hate. There's the wily old veteran in his wheelchair. There's the lad and his dad. There's the movie nerds who would have probably have been us.
Yeah.
And it's interesting how it plays out, the narrative between what's happening in the movie and what's happening with the audience. Because, like, there's a part where they bring an audience an undercooked chicken. And they all eat it except for one man. And they all get dead ill. And it's just hilarious because it's as if, you know, in films these days especially, you feed 90% of the audience any old shite, they'll lap it up and pay for it. But if you're persistent and you sort of steer clear of the easy way through a film, you know, you're going to see it out till the end, which I thought was quite an interesting way of saying it. But you've got to see it. You've got to see this film, because you will... It's no, oh, it was okay, or, it was alright. You'll either think it was brilliant, or you'll think it was cack. I mean, I'm a man of simple pleasures. I like my beer cold, my TV loud, and everything else flaming. But I like this film because there was stuff getting blown up. It was about a killer tire. And did I say the stuff got blown up? It's brilliant. It ticks all boxes for me, so watch it. It's on, I think it is, I found it on Netflix.
All right.
Have a look for it and just give it a watch because it is, it's an amusing film and you won't feel disappointed or cheated from watching it because stuff gets blown up.
To carry on the same sort of sentiment, really, it's the perfect example of a Marmite film, which is how I like to describe it, because as Gaz quite rightfully said, you either absolutely love the film or you absolutely hate the film. Now, when we started watching it, there's a little speech at the start which got me hooked into it straight away.
You probably never gave it a thought, but all great films, without exception, contain an important element of no reason. And you know why? Because life itself is filled with no reason. Why can't we see the air all around us? No reason. Why are we always thinking? No reason.
So from the moment that started, I was just instantly hooked into it because it put in a lot of thought-provoking ideas and the idea of the no reason. And when that speech was going on, I kept thinking, that's a very valid point. That's a good point as well. And it makes you think about things a lot differently. And I think that's the beauty of this film, really, is the fact that it plays so nicely between two crowds. I mean, as Gaz quite rightly said, there's explosions and things like that. So it plays to that crowd. But because of all the thought-provoking stuff in this film as well and the way it's put together, it appeals to the kind of the film lovers crowd, like the real sort of film philosophers and all those kind of people. So it appeals to people like me, for instance. Robert the Tire.
What a name. Give that man an Oscar.
He's an interesting character. I mean, to a degree, we got a Wally-style opening to him because he doesn't talk because he's a tire, so we get a very silent opening to him and we don't actually get any sort of dialogue from him or anything like that.
As you would, tire.
Yeah, but that's what you kind of expect.
Tires don't talk.
I know that, but it's what you kind of expect. And you don't get that, which is, it just lets the visuals tell the story. I mean, when he went on his adventure, he went on a kind of march into this town, and I just couldn't help but put this over the top of it. And to say the same thing that Gaz did before, I really like the idea of the audience spectating what's going on in the film, because it made you kind of look at them and realise, oh, right, okay, yeah, that's how an audience would. I mean, there's a bit in it where they're talking about, oh, the film's just starting, oh, I hope it's not a silent film, and all little quips like that, and you think, yeah, that's how an audience would talk. So it is really, really clever in that delivery of the audience part of the film. There's a bit towards the end of the film as well where they're trying to capture Robert the Tyre because he's gone on a mad killing spree and all that, and they send this dummy in.
You like me? You think I'm sexy? Come on, be a good boy. Blow my head off, you big slut.
But I personally think that's the worst thing you could have said to someone as a tyre. I think they should have just done this instead.
Come on! Come on, you asshole! Kill me! Kill me now! Go on! Do it!
But all in all, it's a very, very quick sit. It's 89 minutes. It doesn't outstay its welcome. It's, as I said, it's a quick sit. It's entertaining. It's thought-provoking. It's a well-made film, and I'm so glad, in a way, that it hasn't got the massive critical acclaim that it should deserve, really, because you know what would happen. Someone in the States would come on and go, I love that film, I'm going to buy it. And then we'd have loads of stupid sequels like those Paranormal Activities. So,
how much could you actually do with a tyre, though?
You could, well, how much could they do with a couple of ghosts and a homemade video?
But this is a tyre.
Yeah, but you get the point.
Jack, I'm gonna actually might harbour for this one day when I win the lottery and take over the world.
Yeah.
That Disney buy the rights to it and give the tyre a voice.
Basically, Pixar do it. And have John Ratzenberger as a hubcap or something.
But you can just imagine the tyre kind of. If you crossed, it would basically be if you crossed Texas Chainsaw Massacre with Flubber. You know, the tyre going into like amusing shapes and stuff.
Aye, you could do that.
I would like that.
Aye. But to close off my review, it's one of those films I believe you need to see to believe. Because you watch the trailer, and I think you get one aspect of it, but there's so much more to it. I think it's been marketed as this sort of killer tyre thing, but there's a lot more to it than just that. So I really do believe, as Gaz said, you need to see it. And with it being on Netflix, you've got no excuse really to sit down and watch it. Well, that's Rubber. Do you want to do your review or your total score?
Yes. This is probably one of the most bizarre films I've ever watched. Just to follow on what we said, I don't think I would like the man from Pixar, what's his name?
Which one?
John Ratzenberger,
he's the guy who voices Ham and Mac.
I would like Brian Blessed to do the voice instead.
No, but you got to have John Ratzenberger in there somewhere if it's a Pixar.
Oh yeah,
film.
He would be in there.
That's
somewhere.
That's why I said he'd play Hubcap or something.
He'd be in there somewhere, but I would like Brian Blessed to do the voice of the tyre. That is the voice of impending death right there. Brian Blessed.
Gordon's alive, but you're not.
Yes.
It's been a good year.
Yes. But yeah, I'm going to give this film a 3.
3?
Yeah, it's just a crazy, crazy film. For the fact that there are bits in it, until shit starts getting blown up, you do feel it's a little bit too arty-farty for a man with tastes such as mine. So, but it redeems itself because stuff gets blown up. It's about a killer tyre. Come on. You know, it's never going to set the world on fire.
He might.
He got angry when he seen tyres being burned.
Ah, he did.
But it's about a killer tyre. You know, give it a watch. Did I mention it's about a killer tyre that blows things up?
I'm going to give it a 4. I'm not going to give it a 5 because it isn't a perfect film. It's a very good film, but it's not a perfect film. But it's definitely worth the viewing time because, as I said, it's very thought-provoking, it's well-made, and it's just an interesting idea. I mean, how many times can you say, I watched a film with a killer tyre?
I think I've nearly broken the record in this review.
Yeah, exactly. No, but, how many times can you say that, really, to someone? Like, oh, I watched a new film last night. Oh, what was it about? It was about a killer tie named Robert.
It's genius.
Need I say more, really? So it's a 4 from me.
And a 3 from me.
Well, that's it for Rubber. No, it's not a dirty film.
No, don't. Whatever you do, for the love of sweet breakfast meat, I was trying to find out more information about this film, so I typed Rubber into Google.
I would say, delete that.
Right, so that's it. Thanks very much for watching, and this was the first week of... You're not going to say it.
No! Leave that to him!
Alright, okay. But Adams, what month is it?
Fan Appreciation Month.
So join us next time for week 2 of Fan Appreciation and the final week of Fan Appreciation Month, because we do 2 a month now, but there you go. So thanks very much, take care, and we'll see you next time for the final week of Fan Appreciation Month.
Ghost!